you want to evaluate it according to your specific needs. Use what you're comfortable with. Again, with that fear monster, if technology makes you nervous or it's pushing you beyond your limits, a tool is, you know, consider an alternative that works for you right now. Sometimes we are told that a tool will be more efficient if we use it this way now, but the truth is if you're not ready for it, just go the long way for now.
You want to evaluate it according to your specific
The last bullet point here
use what
some of the best advice
with.
I ever got from,
again, with that fear monster.
If technology
she recommended
nervous,
to treat myself
where it's
at the
pushing
level
you
that
beyond
I
your limits,
to be
the tool
at.
Is, so I had
you know, consider an alternative
goal.
That works for you right
she
now.
Recommended
sometimes we are told that the free
a tool
option
will be more efficient if we use it this way now,
but the truth
is
if you're not ready for it, just go the long way for now.
So
you want to evaluate it according to your specific
The last bullet point here
choose what you're best
I ever got.
Thank you. Tier up to 2,000 subscribers. Your newsletter service is free. The only problem with MailChimp is that if you are a business where you segment the population on your newsletter for different types of services, MailChimp will charge you for every time you add someone to a different type of list. So that's the simplest way I can explain it. So that's why I prefer something like ConvertKit. Emma is still used. It's very pretty. So if you're into sending very pretty emails, but you don't send very large ones, I might recommend Emma. Constant Contact here in the middle on the left is great. I follow quite a few people, actually. I get their email newsletters, and they still use Constant Contact, and it's a great service. And then Entreport, if you're running a larger business, Entreport is an option. Entreport, ActiveCampaign, and Infusionsoft, while they do email lists, they also offer a lot of other options that help you run and grow a business. So it's worth going to their websites and looking if you are interested in more marketing options than just email, because they will definitely address those needs for you. And then we've got a couple others here, AWeber and Drip. I know a few other people who use those services and they enjoy them. But for some reason, I always hear a lot of rave reviews about ConvertKit, and I happen to be one of those people too. Social media management is our next group. In the upper left, we have Meet Edgar, and I love Meet Edgar because what it does is something that none of these other services do. Meet Edgar made its name because over time, it will keep track of your most popular social media posts. And what it will do is it will notice, even if you have a post that's old, like I had one for a long time that went viral, and every few months it would spring up again because somebody would share it. And Meet Edgar would notice that that post had gained traction again. And it will automatically schedule that post to be posted again in current real time, because if it's showing up again in the newsfeed, people are more likely to re-engage with your content. So it recognizes what your most popular content is, and it also gives you a lot of feedback in that way. Let's say you are a blogger and you write about a lot of different topics, and one topic in particular constantly gets reposted by Meet Edgar. That would be a really good indication that maybe the people who are following you would prefer to see more of that and not of the other things that are not getting reposted. HubSpot in the upper right is a very popular and a very reliable social media management tool. You can go in, create posts ahead of time, schedule them. That's what all of these will do. Sprout Social as well. Sprout Social has some pretty interesting analytics. My experience with Sprout Social is it did not integrate with Instagram, but a lot of these don't integrate with Instagram, so they're not unique in that way, but it was kind of annoying. TweetDeck is an old dog if you're really into Twitter. And Hootsuite has been around for a long time as well, and they are a very reliable source for pre-posting content across all of your platforms and being able to manage them. Landing pages and sales pages is our next group. So for people who haven't been to one of our programs here before at the library, if you're not familiar with what a landing or a sales page is, it's a one-page website page. Where you explain what it is that you are selling, your service or your product. You include testimonials and you really tell people about what you're doing for them. And then you invite them to come and buy your service or buy your product. You can see these all over the internet. If you start paying attention, you'll notice that we actually come across landing pages quite frequently. If you're ever on Facebook, a good example is when you see an advertisement for someone offering some kind of a retreat or a service or something, and you click on that advertisement, it takes you to their website, to a page, and that's usually a sales page or a landing page. So in order to build one of these, you can build them in your website, like if you have WordPress. If you have WordPress, you can use InstaBuilder, which is the second row on the right. And InstaBuilder is a WordPress plugin that works really great. But a lot of these other services, you can actually take code and plug them into your site. So for example, ConvertKit, I have that on the bottom left again. ConvertKit integrates, you have a plugin that you plug to your WordPress website, and you can actually select when you create a page. In your page settings, you can say, select this landing page from ConvertKit. You can find the one that you made, and it will just automatically display your landing page. If you download the PDF slides from me today, you will notice that is the experience that you will get. Lead pages is in the upper left. That is a major player, as well as Optimized Press, in building landing pages. Both lead pages especially, I've attended some of their webinars online just to see what they were talking about, and they were really helpful, really good. Instapage is another one. Infusionsoft offers landing pages, Entreport as well, but they also include other services. You saw those two names on previous slides, so you can see how services like those, you can tell that you're going to be paying more, but they're going to offer you a whole bunch of things that you can do within one service. And then at the bottom right, I also have SamCart again, because even though SamCart is a payment system, it is also a landing page. So landing pages are really great. You know, if you don't want to maintain a large website, this is something we talked about in a previous term. You can just have a single page that tells people how they can contact you, what it is that you offer, and here's a payment button. It's a great way to send your clients to that page, make it really easy for them to pay you and book your time, and it just increases the productivity of your business as well as the professionalism. So we've made it through a few more things on our monster list of topics. Our next one is video conferencing. In the upper left, we have Zoom. Zoom is my new favorite. Zoom is free. They do have paid options as well, but I only use the free option. My partner and I actually do metaphysical readings for clients, and many of them are not where we're located, so we do it over Zoom, and even people who live in other countries. And what we do is we create a meeting in Zoom. We send them the link at the time and day that we're supposed to meet online. Everyone clicks the link. We all get onto the conference, and Zoom allows us to record the reading. It's included in our free program. And then afterward, I'll extract the audio recording and I'll put it into Dropbox and send the Dropbox link to our client where they can pick up their audio recording, because usually those files are way too big for email. So Zoom is really, really lovely. You can also have multiple people on your conference. And if you're using the free version, they'll cut you off after 40 minutes if you've got like three people on a conference. But if you pay for Zoom, obviously they'll let you do a lot more than that. BlueJeans is in the upper right. BlueJeans is something that I really love. BlueJeans allows you to see everyone else who's in the conference with you. You can talk with them, you can share files with them. It works really well. It's very similar to Google Hangouts, which is in the middle. But if you're either not a super big Google fan or you need some other services, there's a little bit of difference between BlueJeans and Google Hangouts. Then you can look at the information of both of those on their websites. Google Hangouts is really great. I've used that in business settings where people log in for meetings, for staff meetings, and it actually works really great. The only problem with Google Hangouts is once you start getting over a dozen people on a Hangout, it kind of starts to poop out a little bit. So it's better for small groups. So a good example would be, like, I'm about to launch an online course, and on that online course, I'm actually going to try doing it with Google Hangouts to start. I'm really not ready to invest in something like BlueJeans. I really want to test out my concept first, see if everyone likes meeting face-to-face like that. Because I like teaching groups like we do here in the library in person. So I'd like to extend that more, but do it online. So we're going to try using Google Hangouts, and I have a feeling for the small-sized groups that I work with, it'll actually work out great, and we won't need to do anything super fancy. But BlueJeans is a great option, and a lot of universities use BlueJeans. That's how I know about it for my graduate work. And the bottom, we have Skype and Skype for Business. Skype is, a lot of us have used it, it's free, it's great. You can do chat service, you can chat with people face to face or just over voice. Skype for Business, I put that over here on the lower right because it's included in the Microsoft 365 package. Microsoft actually bought Skype, which is interesting. And Skype for Business allows you, if you're running a business, you can incorporate voice over IP options for your business. Google also will do that for you. Google has Google Voice. I didn't include phone conferencing in here, but both of those will help you with that. So I included that here because that is a really useful option if you have staff, if you have people who work for you. All right, webinars are really, really big right now, whether you're online or you're trying to bring in more business. I think it's a misconception that only online business owners are using webinars. I personally would love to see more people who do in-person services use webinars to try to get more people to understand what they do, because you can put a recording up on your website or your YouTube channel and people can still watch it later, which is pretty nifty. Again, on the upper left is Zoom. Zoom does webinars. I belong to an online incubator and we use Zoom when we tune in for webinars. It's pretty awesome. BlueJeans, again, on the upper right, they do webinars as well. Webinar Ninja is really popular right now with a lot of online entrepreneurs. So I've seen it tested and used, and it actually does some really beautiful things. Very easy to use. Webinar Jam in the middle on the right. I've attended other people's webinars through Webinar Jam, and it works fantastic. The chat looks really nice. Click Meeting is another popular one, an easy webinar. And then on the bottom right, GoToMeeting. That's something I've used more in the corporate landscape, but I really love GoToMeeting. I've always found that the webinars on GoToMeeting look really beautiful. Being able to show someone a screen share in a webinar is a really lovely thing if you need to demonstrate and then show them what it is that you're doing. And then online teaching, one of my personal favorites because I do online teaching. So online teaching, here on the bottom row, Skillshare, Udemy, and Teachable, these are all hosted options. So what it means when something is hosted is that you are putting your lecture, your class up on their website. You're not putting it on your website. You can build links from your website, but the video and everything is stored within their servers. So if you don't want to maintain a website, or let's say you just have a landing page for your website, but you teach online, using something like Teachable or Skillshare could be really, really helpful, really useful for you, because it takes that burden of having to maintain all of that technology off of your plate. So I actually really love hosted options. I think they're really great. I've been particularly impressed with Teachable lately. I think they offer really great things, and they also have a free tier version right now, which is kind of amazing when you think about it. And if you need to get your content out there more, being able to host it in a place where people can search and find your information beyond your own community is pretty neat. But if you are doing maybe some high-end courses, or you have your own website and you want to host them, whatever your needs are, we have some other options for you. Kajabi in the upper left, they are a major player, and they do some pretty amazing features with their online courses. Zippy Courses is great. It integrates beautifully with WordPress, as does Access Ally in the upper right. Access Ally is part of a larger suite of things called Ambition Ally, and they it's really gorgeous. I'm actually working with a coach right now, and she showed me the back end of her Access Ally course, and it was really awesome. Moodle's in the middle row on the right. I actually took in my library and archiving days, I had an online course, long distance, and they distributed all the course information over Moodle. Moodle is an open source program, so that means that the code is free. Yay. But if you need a little more help and you're not a website programmer, Moodle might not be the best option for you, even though it's free like that. Personally, if I was in the situation of being less technically adept, it made me a little bit nervous, I would use something like Teachable and start with their free tier, because they really walk you through it. They have great webinars. They teach you how to do it. And there's a really big community out there of people who can help you. Video production, that's our next one. So one of the other things I do, in the many things that I do, I will edit videos. I produce and edit videos. I do videos with my partner, and I also edit videos for other clients. So my personal editing tool of choice is Camtasia Studio. They're built by a company called TechSmith, and I'm a little partial to them because TechSmith, their headquarters is in my hometown in Michigan. So I love TechSmith, and I love their products. Camtasia is also really, really easy to use. I was introduced to it when I was in graduate school, and it was very easy to pick up. Camtasia also allows you to do, if you're going to like record a lecture and you want to highlight different, literally visually highlight different things in your lecture, what people are seeing on your computer screen, or if you're using slides, you can do that with Camtasia. So that's pretty cool, and they make it really easy. Easy Video Suite is something that was recommended by someone in my business community, and I love everything I see about Easy Video Suite. I would consider using this as well. It really is easy. It makes it really easy to create a video and just get it out there. ScreenFlow is a very popular one, as is Final Cut Pro. They're a little more professional, a little more high-end. But they're really great. Wistia is another popular video editing program. And then in the right corner here, I included the iPhone and iMovie because so many people are doing things on their mobile devices now that knowing that you can edit your video within your iPhone or on your iPad is kind of amazing. iMovie was the first program I ever used to edit any kind of video. If Camtasia ever failed me and I hadn't, say, signed up for Easy Video Suite yet or something, I would go back to iMovie because it comes with my laptop. So if you're an Apple user, just know that you have some pretty powerful video editing tools already at your fingertips, and they come with the hardware that you purchase, whether it's your phone, your tablet, or your laptop, or a desktop. So I haven't seen that type of easy video editing abilities in the non-Apple-based products so far. I know that there are apps you can get and so forth. So if you are on, say, an Android, or if you use a lot of Microsoft programs, or if you're at home on your computer and you're a Linux user, you would definitely want to do some research and look for apps that play well with those operating systems. We're getting through our list of things. We're more than halfway. Okay, and we still have a lot of time. Project management. This is one of my personal favorites. It's one of the things I work with the most when I work with my clients. Getting organized, document management, and project management. In project management, my personal favorite is right there in the top of the middle. It's called Asana. I was told that it's actually pronounced Asana, but everyone calls it Asana, so I keep calling it Asana. Asana is pretty amazing. You can use it like a simple checklist tool if you want, but you can also use Asana to assign work to other people. You can collaborate with other people. You can put due dates and build a calendar of how you're going to get this project done. I use Asana as well as an idea file. I think it's particularly powerful in that way. I can move my thoughts around. Sometimes I just need to get them out of my head into a place where I can store them so I don't forget them. It integrates on all my mobile devices, on my iPhone, my iPad. I can log into it on my web browser. It's great. I love it. And I use the free version. They do have a paid version, but the free version is so robust. It's like, I just can't believe that they give it away for free. Trello is in the upper right. I would say Trello is the nearest competitor to something like Asana. I do like Trello. Everything visually looks like little cards almost. So it's almost like a card sorting exercise. The way my brain works, Trello just doesn't work as well. I feel like too much gets tucked away in a place that I can't find it. So, but I have used Trello to collaborate with other people on other types of projects. And I'm not opposed to it. It's just not my first choice because I've been using Asana for so much longer. I included Box again in the upper left. So Box is a document management program, but it also allows you to assign work, leave notes for people. So when you're collaborating within a larger organization, so again, this is a good situation if you have staff or if you have interns, people who come and work with you. Maybe you collaborate with other business owners or clients. If you're using Box to store and share your files, being able to turn off a share button with someone, say you can have access to this now the project's over, I'm gonna take away the access. Assign an intern work. When they log in, they will actually see all the work that is assigned to them. They'll get email notifications as well. It's pretty cool. You can reduce a lot of your emails back and forth with people and improve your records management within your organization using a tool like Box. Basecamp is pretty awesome. I've used that in the technology arena in the corporate world, but I've also seen a lot of online entrepreneurs using it lately, and I find that really, really interesting. Basecamp is another way where you can start to brainstorm ideas and see them go from the brainstorm all the way to execution. And it's very user-friendly, it's pleasing to the eye, it actually makes it kind of fun. DePulse over on the right in the middle, it's a pretty cool program if you're assigning a lot of work to people and you need to see things in a linear fashion. You'll notice that there's kind of a trend happening here. There's a lot of visualization happening with the way the information is being stored and organized. So DePulse visually, and the way that Trello looks like cards on a screen, DePulse looks like a linear line, like you're sprinting from left all the way to right. So DePulse allows you to basically manage your projects and break them down and see them visually. But you do have to pay for it. It's not cheap. I do know that. 17 Hats is right in the middle. I know a lot of people who use 17 Hats. It's just another way to organize all your information. It has a lot of really nifty features, but I personally don't use it a lot. On the lower left is Slack. Slack's pretty awesome. If you need to have discussion groups with people, this is really great. Slack will allow you to provide a discussion where people can tune in. They can have an app on their phone where they can tune in as well. They can leave comments, they can share information, and so forth. I've been to conferences like South by Southwest where a company will present on a topic and they'll create a Slack channel where all of us from that conference can get on and we can share information even after the conference is over. So that's pretty nifty. I find that Slack, if you need a place where people can discuss and you're trying to avoid a Facebook group, Slack might be a really, really good option for you. Even though I still think Facebook groups are a really great way to bring people together because it's free and a lot of people use Facebook, let's be honest. On the lower right is SharePoint. That again comes from the Microsoft suite. If you have Office 365, you will also get SharePoint. It can be a little more complicated. They've tried to make it easier over the years, but that is a project management tool and it's really good for sort of large scale projects. Photo and video management. This is one of my personal rally cries to the world because so much of our digital information gets tucked away. It's out of sight, out of mind. We close our computer and we just forget that everything is a mess inside the computer. And there are better ways to organize our stuff so we can find them. And I am just as guilty in my life. Like, I need to make time to organize my photos. But I used to be a blogger, and having your photos and your videos organized is a very powerful way to make more money and gain more traction on your items. Because if you can't find your stuff, you got a problem. I used to work with a photographer. I helped him get his photos organized in Adobe Lightroom. Because he was a big Photoshop user, and he was turning down business because he could not find photos that a stock agency was asking him over and over again, will you please share these photos so we can put them out there and you can make some money? And he kept saying, no, no, no. And his reason was because he couldn't find them. It would take him too long. And that just kind of hurt my heart because I was like, you're just pissing away money. That's just bad. So getting your photos organized, that's a really good example of someone who, once he got his photos organized, he was able to work with stock agencies, and all of a sudden he had all this residual income coming in, and it was pretty amazing. So there's other things aside from Adobe Lightroom. If you're not a Photoshop user, because as we know, Photoshop, the Adobe Creative Suite can be expensive, there are other options for you. On the lower right, I included the Microsoft logo just to stand for if you're on a Windows operating system, like if you're using a Dell computer or a Lenovo or something, and you have Microsoft Office for home, your computer usually comes with a Microsoft Photo editor and manager, and you can organize your photos. I always say when it comes to organizing information like this, you really don't need anything special. You can organize your folders and your documents with neatly titled folders and get everything organized that way. The problem is usually we don't take the time to do it. It's kind of the long way of doing it, but it is a way of doing it. In the upper right, I have Apple Photos. If you're an Apple user, just like a Microsoft computer, you also have a photo storage system. And the thing I love about Apple Photos is it actually gives you space for things like what's called metadata. So spaces for you to title your photo, to tag people's faces, things like that. But if you start acquiring a lot of photos and videos, sometimes that can become a little unwieldy. So if you use something like Google Photos on the upper left, that you can use that to organize your photos a little bit easier, but it's pretty comparable to Apple Photos. In the middle, I have these two. Wyden, and Smart Image. Smart Image is actually a product of Wyden. Wyden is a company based in Madison, Wisconsin. They have a product called the Media Collective, which is a large-scale digital asset management system. And Smart Image is their scaled-down version of the more fancy Media Collective product. So what I love about Wyden products, whether you're using Media Collective or Smart Image, is that you host your photos and videos with them. So they take care of the storage for you. So if you have a business where you are creating a lot of content, photos and videos, that storage can actually balloon pretty quickly if you're doing a lot of work. And what you do in a digital asset management system is you organize your photos in a way where you can just type into a search bar, you know, cats on bicycles, I'll use that example, and you'll find all your photos of cats on bicycles. Or if you're, let's say, doing some videos, you could say, you know, cooking with meat. Maybe you do a lot of cooking videos on YouTube, for example, and all the videos where you have tagged it for the category meat, for example, they will all come up. It will also allow you to create ways of sharing your photos and videos outside of yourself, outside of your business. So if you're working with a client, for example, let's say the Food Network picks you up and they say, well, we need to see some examples of your cooking videos. You can create a beautiful landing page where they can go and preview all those videos from your digital asset management system. You don't have to worry about them taking the videos because you're not sending them through email. So they can't steal your intellectual property that way. They can only preview them. If you wanted someone to be able to download the images, let's say you're a wedding photographer, you can put your images up there and organize them by client, and then you can actually send them the preview online, and they can go and make their selections, and actually you can communicate through that program, which is pretty powerful when you think about it. So depending on what kind of business you have, if you have a lot of photos and videos, this is one of my personal favorite areas because I just think there's so many businesses where we tend to squirrel away the creative assets that we have, and we don't realize that they actually have a lot of dollar value in them for the future. All right, our next one is password management. This is a big one that comes up. I've had some older clients especially, but there are younger clients too with the same problem. People who cannot remember their passwords. And of course, we all don't want to have the same password on everything, which many of us are guilty of. And so these password management programs help you, especially if you're working with people in your organization. Let's say you take on an intern, or let's say you're having your website redone and you're going to share logins with that person who you're eventually not going to work with anymore. You can use these password management tools to give them a login, to change your passwords all in one swoop, that kind of thing, and keep your accounts safe. 1Password in the upper right is pretty great. They were in beta for a while and they were free, and then they changed and they became a paid service. But they are pretty awesome. What you do is you go in and you basically create a record, almost like an address book of, here's my website, these are my logins, blah, 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 blah. And then your file creates 1Password, and you use that 1Password to log in for basically everything. That's kind of the easiest way to explain 1Password. KeyPass is, in the upper left, is a file program similarly like that, like just like an address book. You have your website, you have your login information, but you have to go in and you look up the information. KeyPass will automatically generate a random password, and they're really complicated. They're just pure gibberish, which is good. So if you need something like that, that's great. LastPass and Dashlane and Sticky Password are, again, very, very similar, and they're very popular. They are also free, so I definitely love those. KeyPass is also free, I believe. But KeyPass works mostly just with Windows-based systems, not so much with a Mac. But LastPass, Dashlane, and Sticky Password, I believe, will play with your Mac if you are a Mac user. All right, so we just have two things left here. We're going to look at product-based e-commerce software and event and ticketing software. So if you sell products, again, there are lots of ways you can sell your products online. In the upper left, we have Shopify, which, as you know by now, is one of my personal favorites. I have used Shopify, and I love it. It's very easy to use. It's very beautiful. Integrates beautifully with your website. It's so easy to plug in your products into your website, and it looks like yours. It doesn't look like you're on Etsy, say, in the bottom right. Etsy, again, is a hosted version. It's okay. The marketplace is a little overgrown right now. As a former craft seller, Etsy's not my personal favorite. But again, if you are not in the space of hosting your own website and doing all the work that comes with that, doing something like Etsy is really great. But you can also use something like Shopify, which you don't have to have your own website. You can just send them to your Shopify storefront, and it will still look just as beautiful. One of the best commercial, like larger uses of Shopify I've seen is the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. Their museum store online is a Shopify store. And if you go to their website, LACMA, I think it's LACMA.org, you'll see their shop on there, and it's pretty cool. It's beautiful. In the upper right, Big Cartel. Big Cartel's been around for a while, and they're probably the biggest competitor to Shopify right now, so they're pretty good. Lemon Stand is a real popular one. WooCommerce plugs into a WordPress site. And then Magneto is an open source e-commerce platform. So again, open source means the code is free, but if you are not technically inclined, where you don't write a lot of code and that intimidates you, that's probably not the best option for you. Events and tickets. As someone who does live events and live classes, I particularly love this slide. Never discount the power of a Facebook event. Facebook events in the upper left. It's free to create a Facebook event. It's also easy to share a Facebook event with other people. But if you need more options to let people know that you are having an event, Eventbrite in the upper right is another good option. They have a free tier that's been used by a lot of people for a long time. But if you're charging for your event, Eventbrite will take commission off of what you are charging. So that's something to note. Pick a Tick here in the middle left, the other orange graphic. They're really, really popular right now, and their interface is quite pretty. So their pricing is also really reasonable. Anytime you're going to charge for an event, if you're taking tickets and you're charging sales, most of these, they're going to charge you something, because obviously you're making money. They want to make money off of you too. Because they are providing you with the technology. Event Farm here, right in the middle, they have an app that is really good. Let's say you're running like a little mini conference or something. Event Farm can help you coordinate that really well. So can Guidebook here down in the lower left. But Guidebook is more expensive. So if you're a larger company and you're willing to put out the expense, Guidebook has a way for you to build an app. It's kind of like drag and drop. It's really, really easy. One of the biggest users I've seen of Guidebook is the South by Southwest Festival. That's a really, really big example. But if you ever go to that festival and you have an actual badge to attend the conference and you go in to select your conference sessions, if you know what Guidebook looks like on the back end, you'll quickly recognize that they're using Guidebook. Guidebook also allows your conference attendees to give you reviews and ratings on all of your different sessions and events. And it'll have it has map capabilities and stuff like that. It's pretty cool. Other comparable ones to Eventbrite are Eventzilla, TicketLeap, EventSmart, and RegPack. So those are all major competitors to Eventbrite. Eventbrite's kind of had like a marketing monopoly on a lot of the space and tickets. But Pick-A-Tick, I think, is starting to pick up a little bit. And they're pretty awesome. They're really good. So we've covered all of the content areas for today. And before we quit, I have one more group of tools for you, because I couldn't help it. Some things that increase productivity. These are some things that just kind of don't fit in the other categories, and I just really like them. In the upper left, Bitly, I love that their tagline is the power of the link. Because if you're doing something like a Twitter post and you're limited to 140 characters, you cannot have some long URL that you're going to share for your Eventbrite event, right? So you can shorten your links with Bitly. If you register for an account with them, you can actually save your links and collect some metrics on what people are clicking on. On the upper right, AppSumo, they're actually based here in Austin, which is pretty awesome. If you go to AppSumo, you'll see what looks like a blog. If you sign up for their newsletters, they will actually send you a lot of like software deals and whatnot. That's actually how I got my copy of Camtasia. I got it for way, way cheap because TechSmith was coming out with a new version. And before the new version was released, they partnered with people like AppSumo and they said, hey, send this out to your community and offer them to get the old version for super, super discounted price before the new version comes out. And I knew that the old version would be just as fine as the new version, and I will take that cheap price. So they offer a lot of specials and deals and announcements about things coming out. So if you're in that space of learning the things you didn't know that you didn't know, being on a newsletter like AppSumo will help you learn more about what technology tools are out there in the world. It'll expand your universe a little. In the middle here is a tool called Flux. Flux is a plugin that you add to your device, and what it does is it takes the blue light out of your screen. You can set a timer for yourself. So in case you didn't know this, our screens that we look at emit blue light, and if you work late at night, like I like to do, that blue light can actually stop you from getting a good night's sleep or falling asleep very quickly. So if you take the blue light out, it will actually improve your restful state, which is a good thing. Also good to use like if you have kids or something, so that they're not like all wired late at night. Google Alerts here on the left is really great. It's a good way to keep track of who's talking about you or any other topic that you're interested in. You'll get alerts that come into your email, into your Gmail account, and that's a good thing. Zapier here on the left, and then at the bottom, if this, then that. I love those two. Zapier is something you pay for, but it's a pretty powerful tool. Both of these are automation tools. They're kind of like if this, then that called. They have things called recipes. So you say, if you do this, then this happens. So let's say a good example is, if Caesar sends me an email, then this email gets forwarded to Deb, and then it gets filed into my email. It automatically does that for you. You can do that with like social posts and all kinds of stuff. So it can kind of automate some things that happen regularly for you. If you need to organize your brain a little bit more, Evernote is a long-standing program that I still do really enjoy. I just started using Asana more, was what happened. But it is a good program. And then Workflowy. Workflowy is another one that looks really beautiful, actually, when you're laying out your thoughts to keep your brain organized. And then in the bottom right, Habitica. We've talked about this a while ago in one of our classes here at the library, and this is an app that helps you gamify building habits and patterns. So it's really useful, like if you have kids and you need them to clean their room, you can use Habitica and they earn like little points and stuff, and they can start building these little like characters and avatars. But you know, some of us adults are kind of like kids, so if you check your Facebook account too much, you can build yourself a habit of not logging in so often and earn yourself some points and maybe make it a little bit more fun. So I really like that program. And my final word of advice is keep calm and simplify. So even though there's a lot of tools out there, bringing it back home to what we talked about at the beginning, even though there's a lot of tools, you know, if you can look at what you really need, not just what you want, but really look at what works for you. Really try to simplify. You know, look at what tools coordinate with other tools so that you don't have to log into a million things every day. So that if you can automate something, let it automate, you know. But simplifying definitely makes your life easier. And the nice thing is it opens up your time to be creative for your business, but it also allows you to make more money, because if you're busy doing really basic everyday things constantly, you're really eating up your time and your energy in ways that you just don't need to be. And then here I've got a little bonus slide. Learn more from people who show you how to. One of the topics I thought I might do this term, and it got overruled by other topics that just seemed better fits for this term. But one of the things I thought about doing was including an hour of different business owners and entrepreneurs and bloggers who are sharing really, really helpful information out there. So I included a slide of that here today because it coincides nicely with all of the bits of technology. In the upper left, we have Peg Fitzpatrick, who does social media strategy. She co-authored a book with Guy Kawasaki that we actually have here in the library. It's really great. Her newsletter is fabulous. You will learn so much about social media. She does a lot of great webinars. And just so you know, a lot of these webinars that people do are free. They're probably going to try to sell you something at the end, but they're free. Courtney Johnston, right below her, does copywriting. She does amazing things explaining how to break down words in a way that makes it enticing for people to want to listen to your offer. And she has really great products at really good price points as well. Right below her is Jenny Blake. Jenny Blake is a published author, and we also have her books here in the library. She actually has a lot of old blog content that breaks down her writing process and her publishing process. So it's pretty amazing, and her story is very interesting too. And then in the lower left here, we have John Lee Dumas, who's a well-known podcaster. He podcasts for Entrepreneur on Fire 7 days a week. And sometimes he's a bit like, a lot. He's just really, really into podcasting. But you're like, okay. He shares a lot of information for free about how to start a podcast. So you don't need to spend money on some fancy books or programs or anything. He has those too, but you don't need them. And in his information, you can also click on files and you can hear audibly. You can hear the difference between different types of hardware, different types of microphones, the difference between recording on your computer versus using a mixing board. So it's pretty cool. Jennifer Lee in the upper right does business planning for creative thinkers. So if you don't want to crunch numbers, she will teach you how to do it in a creative way, which is an amazing thing. It's truly a gift. Matt Giovannisi, you've heard him before in a previous lecture. He's very funny. But Matt does process breakdowns. So on his website, Money Lab, you can actually go on there and see his entire process of conceptualizing an idea all the way to executing. And he has funny things on there like screenshots of chats with his friends, like, I just released it 5 minutes ago. Why isn't anybody buying it? You know, you can see that he's in the same boat as you, but he tells you exactly what tools he uses, how he did it, and he has videos and everything. It's very helpful. Emmy Wu in the bottom right does video production. She has a great vlog, and she also has a great tools list on her website. And I love her approach. She says, start with what you have. So one of the things we almost did this term, but maybe we'll do it for next term, is a class on video production. And she says, start with what you have. And you know what? That's what I've done in my own life too. My partner and I, we shoot everything on an iPhone, and it works great. So use what you've got. So our next class is going to be Thursday, October 5th at noon, same bat time, same bat channel. And we're going to be doing a whole hour. I'm calling it Business and Technology Answers, kind of like a continuation of today. So what you can do is you can bring your questions. You could even try sending them ahead of time. You could email me if you want. My email is mary@schoolofmoxie.com. Or if you're here at the library, you can come in and pose your question. And what we're going to do is I'm going to show you some librarian tricks because I am still a librarian. And even though I don't work in the library anymore. And what we'll do is we'll actually search and find answers to everything. So if you're like, well, how do you learn how to do this thing? We'll look at some YouTube videos. We'll look at all kinds of things. We'll find an answer. And I'll show you the process that I also use to figure out what I don't know. If you want today's slides, you can pick them up here at the link, schoolofmoxie.com/business-technology-hour. And when you do that, you'll be able to enter your email and hit go, and then a PDF will be delivered to your email. So that is today's lecture. Thanks for coming. Thank you. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you guys later.